center has been in existence for 4 years. This is our fourth year right now. We have some long established traditions in these past 4 years, which is a way of saying that we've actually done, I think, you know, we are new, but we've done things that I think are interesting over the past 4 years, filled in some gaps and created spaces in the Russian field, in particular by being counterintuitive about Russia, crossing disciplinary boundaries, and not accepting the received wisdoms about Russia. It makes for a more interesting conversation. We're also committed to looking at Russia in international context, so that we break away, as many others are as well, from the established models of various studies. In the end, I think Russia becomes more interesting. I should tell you that the distinguished lecture was established in order to showcase to ourselves, to bring together the field, but also to showcase what we consider to be the more interesting, innovative, and impressive, sheerly impressive work coming out of the field. Originally, our speaker was supposed to be Svetlana Boyem, who is a distinguished professor at Harvard University. Professor Boyem died in August. It was a loss to the field. What I'd like to say is something happier, which is that she left behind her fine legacy and a very strong field to which she contributed in many ways. Nancy Condee will be talking about that. Nancy, I think, is also, as we all are, part of that legacy, and we're all a part of a field which we're fonder of. Better things are happening in the Russian field today. It's a good field to be in. We don't have to apologize anymore, as we used to, for being esoteric and inward-looking. And on the contrary, I think we have a lot to teach to other fields as well. It's in a mutual process. Nancy Condee is, I'll give you her immediate, the immediate indicators that we use. She's professor in Slavic and film studies at the University of Pittsburgh. She has more publications than I could reel off just now. I'll tell you quickly about her edited volume recently, a co-edited volume, Cinema of Alexander Sokurov. The 2009 Imperial Trace, recent Russian cinema, which won not only the MLA Scaglione Slavic Prize, but also the Kovach Book Award for the Society of Cinema and Media Studies, which is one more indication, I think, about the ways in which something specific can resonate well outside of the immediate field in question. She's published very widely. The CV is too long. It makes me feel uncomfortable, in fact, because my CV looks very short by comparison. She's published in The Nation, The Washington Post, October, New Left Review, Sight and Sound. In terms of the Russian publications, if you're at all familiar with the field, you should be impressed. НЛО, Сеанс, Знамя, Вопросы литературы, Искусство кино. She's also, one more layer, I can tell you from experience that she's an amazing administrator with a great attention to detail. She runs right now, she's the director of the Center for Global Studies, which is at the University of Pittsburgh and one of the very few federally funded centers, which is a way of also, which is, it's an answer to area studies, if you think about it. And she's about to become a fellow at RANEPA, which is the Russian Presidential Academy of the National Economy, roughly speaking, the Russian equivalent to the French ENA. Or maybe even like Georgetown in the United States. It combines political economy with literature, humanities, all these things, and produces, supposed to be the next generation of administrators and leaders. Nancy Condee is a specialist in cinema, but not simply cinema. And in fact, one of the reasons why she always stood out to us, and why she stood out to me, is because she has a certain capacity to situate film within other contexts and the other context within film. To look at the world differently, in other words, to use cinema as a lens, as a site where things are produced, obviously. Movies are made, movies are watched, but they emerge from certain political circumstances and contribute to those circumstances as well. What she does, in other words, is she crosses boundaries in ways that we in particular find very helpful, but I think anyone would find helpful. As a writer and as a speaker, I would draw your attention to the treat you're about to experience. A very, very strong attention to detail, combing out of what seems to be mundane or unremarkable, things that are actually quite remarkable and unusual, finding meaning in them, speaking about that detail, but bearing in mind both the larger things that can be said about something, and also the things that cannot be said about something, which is again that final warning that I think we should all heed, which is to be careful about received wisdoms. It'd be very easy to characterize Russia in particular in certain ways, but it's too easy, and that there are many more productive ways to do it. In one of my first experiences with Nancy, she spoke at NYU on reenactments of 1812, if you remember this, Nancy. And here we had film clips of Cossacks, right, reenacting 1812. And so they were dressed up in their garb, and they were making their way on horseback, as the case may be. And so my first reaction, because I didn't know better, I said, well, it's kitsch, isn't it, right? Because it is kitsch. And Nancy's response was, well, that's not really a helpful way of looking at it. And she was quite right. Meaning kitsch or no kitsch, there's more to be said about it, about what's being reenacted, what's being created, the fact that these events never actually took place, which is true of most memorializations and reenactments. And in the process, in this particular way, cautioned me, but also opened my mind to things that I hadn't thought were there. That there's more to see, in other words, and there's better ways to phrase things. Today's talk, again, crosses boundaries. We're speaking here about film. The title of the talk is Property Rights, Russian Culture Today, and the Politics of Seizure. And you'll recognize immediately, I think, that this is equally a matter of cinema, property, politics, and on some level, I think, political economy. Nancy Condee, I invite you to the podium.
Thank you. I'll give you your tea back. You'll see on your chairs is something that Svetlana's cousin had sent along and asked to be passed out. He is a film sociologist at Sorbonne and does work on contemporary cinema and also on television, Christian Fiegelson. And he wrote it as a tribute to Svetlana for their own Actualité Juive. No one would mistake the research agendas of Svetlana and Hannah Arendt, with whom she was repeatedly preoccupied, but I ran across a quotation from Arendt's friend and colleague, Hans Jonas, from the New School for Social Research, who said something at her eulogy that reminded me very keenly of Svetlana and Svetlana's work. He said, "Here was an intensity, an inner direction. Even her errors were more worthwhile than the verities of lesser minds. After she examined a problem, it looked different." And I think that's what many of us feel when we read Svetlana's work. It was not a good year for us in Slavic, as you know. Kathy Nepomniachtchi died, Svetlana died, and then a number of others whom I won't enumerate here, but who were much older, in their 80s, even in their 90s. There's only 161 of us, those people in Slavic that work in culture. So we're a very small group of people, and a loss particularly of these two people who might have had a quarter of a century ahead of them of research is most keenly felt. I guess I'll leave it at that. I know that there's going to be a memorial service for Svetlana. But I'm very mindful that while I'm honored to be here today, I'm also mindful of the reasons behind having been invited today. So the talk you're going to hear is in five parts. Some are shorter than others. All of them are brief. But this way you can track through the PowerPoint how we're galloping through Europe, so to speak. It comes in part out of work, Elliot is in the back, out of work that had begun in Maryland and then moves forward from our mutual experience in Maryland, and you'll see your work cited in the midst of it. I work with known texts, texts that I presume you know, so that I don't need to tell the plot, God forbid. But I'm interested in putting those texts in a particular order on the game board so that they they reveal to us new aspects that perhaps we hadn't seen before. And in that sense, what you're about to hear is an argument. It's not so much concerned with teaching you the truth as it is in laying out an argument and seeing what happens if we look at it in this particular way. So that's the, I suppose, the game that I'd like to play. Let's start in part one with the notion of two seizures. It's once again necessary to talk about Pussy Riot. I was inspired once again by the wholly appropriate article in Calvert Journal that Elliot had written, which is just a gem of a piece and worth turning to if you don't know about it already. Considerable ink has been spilled on Pussy Riot. I'm going to limit myself just to the things that are relevant to the current moment. Wearing bright hoods and dresses, five members of this art action group entered the Cathedral of Christ Church, Cathedral of Christ the Savior in February 2012 to perform an idiosyncratic ritual. By everyone's agreement, they're not meant to be there, including the women themselves, but it was a good punk venue and a better venue than the other potentially punk venues they had considered. By March 2012, three of the five were arrested, two of them were convicted. Celebrities like Paul McCartney and Slavoj Žižek came to their defense, and much was written about them. A whole school of graffiti was born honoring Pussy Riot. But then Russian politics moved forward, and the event eventually became the backdrop to lesser but no less colorful events, among them the seizure of Crimea in March 2014 and the invasion of Ukraine in April 2014. But I want to turn my attention to another completely unrelated event, apparently unrelated. In Crimea, 30 months after Pussy Riot had their live performance, in October 2014, 12 masked men, uniformed paramilitaries, presenting no identification or authorization, burst into the main administrative building of the Yalta Film Studio, sealed up the entrances, and declared the studio confiscated from its legal owner. Now, this was not the confiscation from a Ukrainian owner. This was a Moscow businessman who owned Yalta Film Studios, and it was confiscated by Russian paramilitary from its own citizen on newly nationalized Russian soil. It's a minor point, but I want to set the stage up the way I choose. Now, what's interesting to me is the commonalities between these apparently disconnected events, Pussy Riot on the one hand and Yalta Film Studios on the other. The commonalities may be obvious, but there are three that interest me in particular. Number one, both groups, both the girl punks and the paramilitary men, were masked balaclava and uniformed, costumed intruders. Second, they penetrated a space where the routine production of belief, whether it's melodrama of a provincial studio or whether it's the Orthodox rites of the cathedral, is the central function of its mission. And third of all, both the punkers and the paramilitary men came to agitate in that space for views that are inimical to the site itself. For the women, they were agitating for the removal of the president. For the paramilitary men, for the removal of the studio owner. Now, beyond this capricious set of comparisons, I'm not sure what is to be gained. Answer the question provisionally like this. The comparison between the two highlights a major appeal of the punk performance, namely its compatibility with the dominant tactics of state seizure and expropriation, both materially and ideologically. It's arguably the governing trope of contemporary cultural politics. And unlike the 1960s, the dissident oppositional artists, but akin to the parallel cultures of the 1980s, most specifically Sozart and conceptual art more broadly, Pussy Riot included in its portfolio of talents the capacity to mimic the state. Surprise entry without apparent authorization, occupation of the physical territory, and repurposing of the space for an antagonistic ideological project. Indeed, their incursion, performed on the very soleus of the cathedral, travesties first state intrusion and then church solemnity in a frenzy of inspired misbehavior, a demented pageantry of art actionism. It's hard not to like them in the end. Now, as Eliot has pointed out, and I want to refer to very briefly, it's a rich source of irony that the punk drama, which I want to think about as a rogue declaration of eminent domain, occurs at the cathedral, the site not only of an extraordinary act of state vandalism, but also two additional government demolitions in the 20th century. The expropriated cathedral was dynamited in 31, as we recall, to build the aspirational, idealistic, but atheist Palace of the Soviets, which was not completed and was eventually abandoned and dismantled as part of the war effort in 41 to 42. Then the swimming pool was built, in which we all swam, in which we caught unbelievable diseases and parts of the body not to be mentioned, from 58 through the end of communism. It itself was demolished in 94, and in going in a, so to speak, faux circle, the replicate, an inexact replicate all the same, but a replicate of Cathedral of Christ the Savior was rebuilt where Pussy Riot had its performances, and therefore it seems to me that the ensuing persecution of them, conducted by a state whose history includes seizure, demolition, desacralization, and dismantling at the same site, is a little oxymoronic. I'm reminded of the Ambrose Bierce Devil's Dictionary quotation when he talks about amnesty. You know, when the Pussy Riot was eventually amnestied, Ambrose Bierce says, "Amnesty is an act by the rulers, by which the rulers pardon the injustices that they themselves have committed." Right? And here is, for me at least, the clearest example of this coming full circle to amnesty Pussy Riot itself for doing what the state had done. Now, the Yalta Film Studios seizure in Crimea was a little different in this respect, and only a little different, that it was of a piece with, let's say, the Massandra Winery in Yalta that was confiscated, or the Zalif Shipbuilding Yard that in Kerch that was confiscated, and other such enterprises occurring through spring 2014 on either side of the Crimean Declaration of Independence by the Supreme Council. But Yalta Film Studios is different in this respect. Like the Black Sea Television Studio in Simferopol, also confiscated during this period, it is a seizure not only of objects, but of instruments of representation, its media space effectively doubling its ideological value, authorizing future seizures of ritual, family memory, school instruction, leisure habits, archives, artistic texts, architecture of quotidian life, and consciousness itself, in the ways that the seizure, let's say, of the shipbuilding yard does less comprehensively. As school children learned since the early 1920s from the example of the RSDLP-B, when the media site is seized, the Speech Act as a representational practice is also confiscated. And so, therefore, I would argue that this is a particularly interesting moment of seizure. Now, I want to add a third seizure in part two. Again, working with a text that you know, but I'm hoping placing it on the board in such a way that you begin to see the dots connected anew in a different kind of way. In February 2015, there was an unsuccessful bid by Andreas Vyakuntsev, director of the drama Leviathan, for the Academy Award here in the United States. He took 9 months of criticism for his alleged Russophobic, anti-Orthodox, and anti-Putin film, and then went home empty-handed because the prize was given to Pawlikowski for the 2013 drama Ida, a spectacular film, by the way, but sad for Zvyakuntsev. Now, this was the closest that Russia had gotten to the Oscars since Mikhalkov's 1994 Burnt by the Sun. Let's remember very briefly what the film is about. This is, I hope, the only plot summary I will give you. It recounts the struggles of an ordinary auto mechanic, Nikolai, who lives in a coastal town, facing municipal seizure of his family home through the collusion of a corrupt mayor and local bureaucrats and church officials who turn out to be important. Nikolai is offered a miserable sum and loses the legal right to contest the seizure. His attempts to resist prove his undoing and the destruction of his family on a scale reminiscent of Job, who is cited at the film's ending. Produces a tragic conclusion. In a final irony, the hero's family home is razed for the construction of a garish Orthodox church, and in a nod to Hobbes, the film's Leviathan, a mammoth whale skeleton stranded on the beach shore, implicates both contemporary Russian state and the skeletal remains of the Soviet state. But Zviagintsev's ambitions are larger than anti-Putinism. Faithful to the Russian anti-clerical tradition, the film, I see it as a polemic against contemporary Russian neo-pietism that increasingly colludes to render property rights concessionary and revocable. And here I'm turning to two sources in the kind of boiler room of this talk. One is Gerald Easter, whom some of you from social sciences may know, and the other is Perry Anderson, who recently had an interesting article in Critical Quarterly. Critical Inquiry, not the British Journal, Critical Inquiry. At his most elegant, Zviagintsev inverts a powerful cliche. If the Orthodox Church rallies against the assault by secularism upon the sacred site, so Pussy Riot was such an assault of secularism on the sacred site, then Zviagintsev inverts this and talks about the church as a predatory being that mounts an assault upon the modest aims of secularism, the home, the family, the secular life as such. Now, let's look at these two things side by side, Pussy Riot and Zviagintsev. One is Old Testament style epic, the other is bratty and engaging. And yet the filmmaker's explicit citation of Pussy Riot graffiti signals his allegiance with the punk performers. The clue is hardly surprising. The clue on the television set that flickers towards the end of the film. Their shared target is theocratic exceptionalism. That is to say, an institutional church that, even beyond the supererogatory practices of the state, functions as a hyperstate or a meta-institution answerable only to its own idea of itself. As Masha Gessen has described it, the state and the church merged into one mechanism of persecution. But there's an odd coincidence that first grabbed my interest in this connection between Pussy Riot and Zviagintsev and suggested that it's not merely an undergraduate essay about similarities, but rather that there is something more global or more environmental that's happening that the two are a symptom of. Pussy Riot member Maria Alyokhina speculates in her closing trial statement in August 2012, long before Zviagintsev's film was even in the advanced shooting stage, and she could not possibly have known of this. She speculates about a scenario that eerily anticipates Zviagintsev's closing episode. In her closing statement, as in the film, a mammoth excavator destroys the family home. Alyokhina says to the courtroom, "If an excavator drives up to their door and these people are told that they have to evacuate their premises because, sorry, we're raising your house and building a residence for a bureaucrat, and these people will come humbly collect their things, pack their bags, and go out into the street." And here, incidentally, is how the state prosecutors turned the table on Pussy Riot. This, incidentally, is the key scene, if you've seen the film, the key scene of the destruction of Nikolai's home. Beautiful scene with the claw coming into the kitchen and ripping out the guts of the house and then raising it completely to the ground. But here is how the prosecutors turned the table on Pussy Riot. Once the punk group took its spectacle to the cathedral, its provocations were no longer a merely social critique, but were instead available to be framed as anti-church and therefore vulnerable to extra regulatory reproval. Though their lyrics included the political invocation to chase Putin out, "Pragani Putina," the court proceedings could risk no mention and did not mention that political phrase, focusing instead exclusively on the anti-religious affront and thereby ushering in Russia's first anti-blasphemy legislation since the dynastic era, so-called Article 148 on the 11th of June, 2013. So now we have set up the board so it has Pussy Riot It has Yalta Film Studio, and it has Zvyagintsev's film. My sense that there was something in the air has to do with the fact that in the past 2 years, there have been a number of films in circulation, contemporary films in circulation, all of which have to do with the imperiled dwelling, the eviction, the appropriation and expropriation of people from their abodes. Leviathan is only one of several such films. In 2014, a domestic competitor with Leviathan within Russia was viewed as a competitor. I don't view it as such, but many people liked better than Leviathan, was Yuri Buikov's social drama, Durak, or Fool, the story of an ordinary worker, like Nikolai, up against corrupt town bureaucrats and real estate investors indifferent to the imminent collapse of the building where the municipal workers live, the dormitory. In the same spirit, Sivala Benigson's 2012 Almanac film, State of Emergency, is set in an apartment building in a state of incipient collapse, and so forth. Sharing a preoccupation with the integrity of the dwelling, these and other films invite a scalable model, potentially a way of talking about the homeland as dwelling and the sovereign body as dwelling. So the building is a kind of a broker that potentially invokes the homeland and the body and sits between it and operates as a kind of allegory of both the homeland and the body in all three of these films and others that I won't enumerate here, as well as some pieces of literature as well, such as Miriam Petrosyan's Nash Dom. Now, it occurs to me a step that I'll just move towards and then away. I'll mention it only in passing. If we were to speak of the provenance, because after all, the imperiled house is by no means a new theme in Russian culture, let me mention very briefly four works that I would consider to be touchstones that germinate forward into the moment that we are looking at right now. First, the closing shots in Sakurov's Russian Ark, as the camera pans out into the unending seascape, suggests that the precious cargo housed in the Hermitage Ark, through which we have had the privilege to tour, becomes lethally vulnerable to state seizure, signaled first with the momentary appearance of the Bolshevik troops that flicker past in the middle of the film, and then by the film's closing threnody, Prashchai Evropa, farewell Europe, as it's clear that the contents of the home have passed out of ownership. A second provenance that I would mention would be Tarkovsky's Sacrifice, where he recounts in his characteristically circumspect way the crisis of the intellectual Alexander, who vainly bargains with a punitive god as he is forced to forfeit his home, his possessions, his wealth, and his family. The film's climax, a spectacularist engulfment of Alexander's house in flames, is both arson and not arson on the part of Alexander. After all, as with Tarkovsky's forced exile 2 years earlier, a punitive authority in both cases, with Tarkovsky and with Alexander, has constrained the hero's options to an unacceptable set of choices, stripping both home and homeland in the same moment. Two other examples before I move away from ancient history. A decade further back in 1976, there are two classic Soviet variants of the imperiled dwelling. Valentin Rasputin's novella, Farewell to Matura, which was made as the basis for the L.M. Klinov's 1983, Prashchanya, Farewell, recounted the confiscation, the eviction, and the flooding of an entire peasant village and became a touchstone in the late 70s and 80s about topic of confiscation. And then Yuri Trifonov's 1976 House on the Embankment, which in a very different mode tells about the state eviction of academician Ganchuk, who had occupied a capacious apartment in the so-called government house overlooking the Moscow theater, as Moscow River, as the central event of this major late Soviet work. And one can conjure up other examples. This is an article yet to be written. I would pass it along to anybody who's interested in it. But my point is that there's backstory to what's happening now that seems to come into an increased intensification at this particular past 3 or 4 years. So as interesting as this so-called provenance talk might be, its prime value is as background to the topic's surge in the second decade of the 21st century. That is to say, if Russian cinema in the early 90s was replete with examples of the concussed hero, the amnesiac hero, the Abdrashitov hero who had banged his head, had a head injury and could recall nothing and would slip in and out of consciousness, a theme that's renewed again by Mizgiryov most recently. And if the mid-1990s in cinema was a time in which we would see over and over again the Cinderella story, this beautiful young woman who was unfortunately very poor, and she would meet a young man who was very wealthy but such a cad. And yet through her love and her belief in him, she was able to transform him. And by the time we would sit through this event, she would predictably forge for herself a happy union. If that's might be seen as a kind of intensification at different years in Russian cinema, then today's recurrent film pattern, I would argue, is this imperiled dwelling, not only in the representational sense, as in the films of Zvyagintsev, Bykov, and Bennigsen, and others, but also in the very sites of cultural production themselves, which I want to turn to now, the very place where art is made. The excavator equipment that had been conjured up by utter coincidence in both Maria Alyokhina's and Zvyagintsev's texts is a striking coincidence precisely because of its looming presence at real-life demolition sites at Russia's key cultural institutions. Among Moscow's most vulnerable have been those centrally located venues that are perilously dependent for survival on audiences, visitors, archival space, library stacks, and live performances. In other words, film is a bit different with its multiple platforms and its availability to be delivered as a video link or a Dropbox or something like that. It's not as vulnerable as those things that are more like this, what we're doing today, gathering people together for a real live experience that is more vulnerable to encountering bureaucratic resistance of the kind that I had been speaking and the kind that relates precisely to Leviathan's film. The most exposed sites are small cultural institutions plagued by a volatile combination of ideological free thinking, unprofitable intellectual work, and lucrative location. So, for example, as I can tell some of you in the audience thinking ahead of this line of logic already see coming, the Cinema Museum, led by the world's leading Eisenstein scholar, Naum Kleiman, had already spent 15 years in perpetual threat of closure to make room for a strip club and a casino. And having finally lost its location in 2005, its screenings had no stable home or adequate support from the Ministry of Culture. Wouldn't you think that the Ministry of Culture would step forward with a world-famous cinema museum known throughout the world and would provide it with some kind of stable existence? Recently, the Cinema Museum was stripped of its director, Naum Kleiman, in July 2014, despite appeals from Cannes Film Festival director Thierry Frémaux, actress Tilda Swinton, and filmmaker Mark Cousins, and many people, including people in the room here that signed that petition. An analogous fate befell the Research Institute of Cinema Art, NI Kineskustva, located again in prime real estate at the center of Moscow. First, it was absorbed into the Ministry of Culture, which is particularly apt because it's a more conservative ministry than the others, more neoconservative, and therefore it can work its magic more effectively, more expeditiously. And then it merged with the geographically distant State Institute of Cinematography. It was temporarily moved for ostensible renovation, and then it lost its quarters, which were converted into a government reception hall. The most famous instance, however, is Theater Doc, forced out of its quarters over and over again. Not coincidentally, its performances included the 2012 protest movement, the lawyer Sergei Magnitsky, and other very sensitive topics. In response, the theater has faced bomb threats, legal charges, fines for fire code and building violations, accusations of bookkeeping irregularities, and other allegations. And one could enumerate further displacements. Golos, the independent voting monitoring association, and Dozhd, the independent radio channel, all of which are subject to multiple evictions, police raids, and suspensions. But the bigger picture for all of it is this, that the marshaling of tax codes, tax laws, fire codes, sanitation inspection, cadastral maps have come to overwhelm not just the institute, the museum, the theater, but independent contemporary culture and its functional survival, logistical survival. So two things occur to me as I think about this. I'm not an investigative journalist. I can't know what's happening, certainly from here, and I'm not trained. But it does occur to me in this context, how do we understand the pattern of fires in central Moscow theaters, which are incidentally valuable real estate sites? I get it that theaters can burn, props and costumes can catch fire, renovations can go awry, electrical repairs can be very, very risky. But let's all the same look at the several major fires in the decade between 2003 and 2013. And then another thing occurs to me, maybe related, maybe not. Let's look at the signatories, the so-called 100 signatories of major cultural figures in the Ministry of Culture in support of Putin's policy in Ukraine. Let's look at them not as famous people. Let's look at them as the custodians of real estate. It's a different prism to look at them through, it seems to me. Here's free speech as a strange thing. It's hampered not by mere censorship, but by something, I would argue, something newly visible, not necessarily new, but newly visible. And perhaps even free speech itself is an archaic concept because it doesn't capture what's going on here, which has more to do with property stalemates and concessionary rights, concessionary in the sense that they can be like a rubber band yanked back again at certain strategic moments. So at its most speculative, my argument is this, at its most tenuous, I think, most vulnerable. To be Western in the early 21st century, to be Western, is to live in the belief, for the most part utterly unfounded, that one may aspire to assert some kind of negotiated control over one's body, one's dwelling, and one's homeland. To be a citizen of Russia might increasingly be to be called upon to embrace a higher patriotic and spiritual path, whereby the body, the dwelling, and the homeland are rendered up to the dual custodianship of the church, of the state and the official church for better uses than are available than to the citizens of the Federation. In the spirit of conjecture, I offer remarks by the newly appointed Russian Crimean Prime Minister, Sergei Aksyonov, who makes my argument better than I could, responding to critics with the unimpeachable logic of an occupying force with or without balaclavas. The Crimean Prime Minister retorts, "Why must we tolerate unscrupulous owners who, thanks to the fact that they had used fraudulent schemes or paid tributes to bureaucrats, stole property that should belong to the state?" By this reasoning, the state seizure is a necessary act of moral reparation. Moreover, state seizure that partners with the official church is more than a moral act. It's a spiritual victory over unscrupulous materialism and acquisitive greed that drives more and more parishioners of Slavic Orthodoxy towards the kind of secular corruption that thrives unchecked in the West. At its core, the central cultural preoccupation is this: can there be ethical ownership that is not state ownership? Or is all private ownership an archaic practice of fraud, corruption, bribes, schemes, and theft, as Crimean Prime Minister Aksyonov thoughtfully suggests? To presume to own private property as a secular legal act is already to violate a different symbolic act between oneself and the state. That symbolic act, which requires a voluntary oath of personal non-sovereignty, like Tarkovsky's intellectual, Alexander, who voluntarily sets aflame his own house to appease a punitive god, is increasingly presided over by the spectral presence of the church. All secular ownership is suspect, and therefore transitory and fortuitous. In this profane and contingent world, one can no more expect to own property than to own one's own body. One may inhabit it temporarily, but without expectation of a right to dispensation. Now, in a sense, this has been true for decades. Pipes has written about it. One could argue that this is nothing new. The shift that I'd like to make is to suggest that that these practices today are different from the metropolitan seizures of the 1990s, when, for example, the bathhouses, valuable downtown property, huge downtown bagni, were seized and converted into restaurants, converted into casinos, and simply closed altogether and razed. I would argue this is different from the 1990s. In the 1990s, such personal initiatives of individual entrepreneurial acquisitions converted the baths for mere local gain. 2 decades later, by contrast, the integration of Russian speculative interests feeds into an accelerated global financialization that has produced a kind of flattening out of material sites. This monetization is prepped by transferring the property into state entities that are ideologically poised for the next step in ways that, for example, the Institute of Cinema Art is completely unprepared. If financial capital at its greatest maturity is non-property, it's invisible, it nevertheless requires a steady interim stream, like pig iron, a scrap of composite materiality, if you will, of centrally located, unprofitable property sites for seizure. The cultural transformation described above is consonant with a recognizable global trend of accelerated financialization, rather than, as some might suggest, compellingly in their own way, rather than Russia's rogue status, so-called outside the family of civil society, or outside the practices of global neoliberal economics. I would argue it's very much a part of global neoliberal economics. Its features involve an accelerated version of Schumpeter's gale, or creative destruction, that David Harvey writes about, the winnowing out and consolidation of social elites, the monetization of common resources, the sharpening of class disparities, the accumulation by dispossession, by seizure, the manipulation of crises, the profitization of public assets, the waning of generative wealth in favor of confiscation or forced buyout, all arguably part of what I would like to think of or refer to as a form of second wave neoliberalism since the 1990s, of which the collapse of the Soviet Union was an early symptom. More particular to Russia's account is the integration of neoliberal practices into an explicitly neoconservative authoritarianism, arguably characteristic of Russia as well, let's say, of India, of Turkey, or of China. And therefore, to try to winkle out the differences, if first wave neoliberalism might be loosely characterized as the historical period of, let's call it, the maximization of entrepreneurial freedoms, that is to say, the championing of private property rights, free market and trade, individual liberties, as well as state engagement, except to facilitate the creation of new markets, then second wave neoliberalism, I would argue, is heavily reliant, in Russia at least, on the coercive power of the state. Apparently just the opposite, you see, apparently just the opposite. Mandatory redistributive practices and state production of investment interests from the threat of so-called развлекательные революции, recreational revolutions, such as we have seen recently. Unlike the dominant trends in Turkey and China, however, where it has arguably been privatization of public resources, in Russia it is a much more arcane affair, not towards privatization, but towards something else that sometimes has been described as concessionary capital. What I want to address is this term which I find very useful, which is called reprivatization. I'm going to pause for a moment and talk about what that is, and then in the final part, we're going to put our feet back on the ground and talk about actual texts in the closing section of the talk. So my point is, culture is not unique compared to other entities in Russia today. Similar practices of reprivatization could be traced about across many social fields. And by this I mean neither extraction from state ownership, let's call it privatization, nor the opposite, state seizure, let's call it nationalization. Reprivatization is a recursive move that partially transfers organizations to a conservative wing of the government, such as the Ministry of Culture, so as to transform them into a parastate entity, increasingly run by politically loyal appointments at the level of the directorship and governing boards, hence Naum Kleiman. The new organization, which is neither privatized nor nationalized, is reprivatized in the way that a sofa can be reupholstered. It's ripped out and it's put back in a way that's more ideologically appropriate, with parastatal figures now holding key governance positions to bring the organization in closer alignment with state goals. In the cultural sphere, the distinctive features are a credible assertion of soft power legitimacy. Soft power legitimacy, first and foremost, means the initiative called Russian World, founded in 2007 as a so-called quango. Quango means quasi-NGO, quango, in collaboration with the church to promote a Russian cultural identity as a global project. Rigorously non-political, that is to say, extremely political, Russian World has aspirations that are analogous, I would argue, in some ways to Globic Islamic civilization, the China dream, the Ottoman glory. In other words, it's a familiar set of aspirations. Arif Dirlek in Boundary 2 has described these aspirations, the Ottoman glory, the China dream, and so forth, as, quote, a mobilizing idea, more a prologue to imperial project in the future than the revival of a recognizable historical entity in the past. Now, I want at this point to move, if my clicker will allow me, to the last part, which is much shorter and open-ended, because I'm not a policy person. So there's no great thing at the end where I say we've got to be rallied and we've got to galvanize ourselves to do X. There's no galvanization is about to happen. Instead, I want to look at a tale of two statues. The first one is familiar to you. In Moscow, two as yet homeless monuments emblematize the current conjuncture. The first is the old one, a monument to Felix Dzerzhinsky, founder and first director of the Soviet secret police. It's a 15-ton tribute that stood from 1958 to 1991, the August coup, in the center of Moscow's Lubyanka Square, opposite the KGB headquarters. It was taken away, toppled, and despite repeated efforts since 1991 to return the monument back to its plinth in front of the KGB headquarters, effort that is supported by 45% of the Moscow population, it's nevertheless remained in its garden of forgotten monuments while the Communist Party tries, as yet unsuccessful, to put it in its place. It has successfully collected 150,000 signatures, which was the required amount to hold a plebiscite, but the plebiscite has, at the moment, has been rescinded and remains in limbo. Equally controversial, but for the same site, a contender for the same site in front of the KGB, is a new statue to Prince Vladimir the Great, the first Christian ruler of an early Slav state in Kiev. It was unable to secure a proper site elsewhere in Moscow, and it's now a contender against Dzerzhinsky for a location on Lubyanka Square. Now, this audience knows that the erection of a Russian monument to the first Kievan prince opposite the Russian security headquarters is not a neutral act. In Putin's speech marking the 1,000th year death anniversary, Putin, whose name day it was Putin's name day, it was his father's name day, it was Prince St. Vladimir's name day, Putin hailed St. Vladimir for nourishing the spiritual sources of fraternal peoples of Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus. And in response, as if this were not overdetermined enough, Patriarch Kirill hailed St. Vladimir as the leader who, quote, nourished the spiritual unity of brotherly peoples of Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus. So each Vladimir, St. Vladimir, who had earlier been a bloodthirsty libertine and a fratricidal pagan, and President Putin, who had earlier been a lieutenant colonel in the KGB, an atheist, and a member of the Communist Party, had both gone through transformations to become the righteous leader presiding over a new era of Christianity, completing the imaginary geography of a reunited empire with the dual custodianship of Vladimir, the state president, and Vladimir, the saint prince. From the perspective, of course, of the Ukraine national history, the Kievan St. Vladimir bears no relationship whatsoever to the northern enemy, which had not even existed at the time of Prince Vladimir's reign. But that is a separate story. Which of these two monuments is best suited to grace the front of Russia's security headquarters, Dzerzhinsky or Vladimir. This contest does not require our adjudication. It's not our problem. They'll know what's best for them. More relevant for us is the juxtaposition of two models of continuity, a Soviet security monument or a new statue to the ancient prince of a former Soviet republic newly invaded by Russian Federation troops. Each of these traditions, it seems to me, is sufficiently sobering that perhaps there's a place for both of them in that site. It may be that this decade, from 2015 until the end of Putin's administration in 2024, if indeed that is the end, we are witnessing the birth of a new polity. On the one hand, the accelerating emigration rate of leading liberal figures, exungulating Russia's intellectual and creative life. Each of us have our own, whom we were very sorry to see leave Russia, among them Sergei Guriev, Galina Timchenko, Marat Gelman, Leonid Birshitsky, and of course, Masha Gessen. So that's the one hand. On the other hand, according to Levada Center, we are seeing an increasingly cohesive country. One would think cohesion is a good thing, all things being equal. An increasingly coherent population. It prefers state planning to market economy, 55% to 27. It tends to support the statement that, quote, all power in a country should be concentrated in the hands of a single person, 50%. In polls conducted by Annenberg School for Communication at UPenn, so it's not simply these corrupt polling institutions in Russia that we're talking about. It supports the shutting down of the internet in times of perceived crisis, 58%, and by 82% supports state censorship of films, books, theater productions, and art exhibits. And this is the point at which we usually become distracted, and I think it is a distraction, talking about, oh, but those polls. One could continue to talk about the polls, and I'm not someone who believes that those polls are necessarily reliable any more than any polls are reliable, and particularly in Russia. At the same time, what I'd like to call attention to is that we change the subject so that we don't need to talk about something that's really very interesting, frightening perhaps, but very interesting, namely an increasingly cohesive culture that bears very little relationship to the people whom we know and that we tend to socialize with and to work with and collaborate with in Russia today. And that consistency of these results nevertheless suggests a kind of growing cohesion that we are presumably uncomfortable with. I want to close with two quotations. Both are scholars that are irritating in their own way. The first is one that I love because it's so wrong. If civilization is what counts, violence between Ukrainians and Russians is unlikely. I forget what year it was, 1993, 94, when the article first came out by Samuel Huntington. But it gives me pause to think, what do we conclude from this? If he was wrong, then is it true that civilization doesn't count? No, it's newly counting now. But it's not counting in ways that are good for us. Right? It's not counting in ways, and you know what, it will probably never matter in ways that are good for us. So I'm less interested in the warfare of this quotation than in the civilization. With apologies to Huntington, counting is something it seems to me we might avoid at all cost. Civilization gets writ large in Russia precisely at those moments when it is most intensely instrumentalized. And I don't see a rousing solution out of that. The second quote I want to look at in closing, is going back to the very beginning of the talk. It's a quotation from Jameson that newly appeared in New Left Review. And one could have one's own fights with Jameson, but I find this quote in particular interesting. He talks about that peculiar and imaginary thing called private property in land that is at stake. Now, that caution might make us recoil at its apparently Philistine preoccupation with real estate over research, over performances, over poetry readings, over ballet, over Moscow art theater. But the volatility of property values has shaped contemporary culture not only in its preoccupations on the screen and in theater performances, but also in its very survival and constrained them in ways that I think are newly fascinating and worthy of looking at. Thank you very much. Now, do I answer questions or do we get to drink something?
Well, we can do both. But yeah. Do you want to start by answering questions and then?
I don't mind. I'm happy to answer questions. It was meant to be, you know, taking things familiar to us and putting the pieces on the board in a new way. But perhaps you would like to argue with the way in which the argument was set up. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Avoided very much to mention a metaphor, or don't maybe it's not a metaphor even more, that is very often used in relation to Russian contemporary state. It's a comparison with mafia and with this kind of practices of expropriating property, basically, which is so typical for mafia. And this property, of course, overcomes very much the land property or real estate or something like that. They are expropriating yukas, they are expropriating kontakte, they are appropriating beeline, they are appropriating banks, and so on. So it's not real kind of real estate, it goes far beyond it.
Okay.
At the same time, you are focusing on places.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is very interesting because I think in Russian culture, places are playing a very special role. It's a very different, I think, cultural configuration in relation to time and places and how history is inscribed into places. So there is very few things similar, I don't know, to American road movies, but there is always something dealing with location. And there is always this kind of pilgrimage now to locations. There are sacred sites that are created everywhere, all this kind of stuff. So, but I think, I don't know, this is my question. Do you think property is so much associated with locality in Russia, with places, or we should basically make distinction between what is happening to property in what is happening with locations, I don't know. So. Or it's something that should be more or less conflated, I don't know. So,
So I'll answer briefly. I'll try not to binge on this question. My interest in pursuing this train of thought concerned the following. Number one, the old argument by Richard Pipes that the problem with Russia, I think my colleagues can cite it better than I, but the problem with Russia is that it didn't have its property rights in place and that this caused all the trouble that we see today. So where I'm headed with this argument next month, the month after, 3 months from now, is to re-engage with Pipes' argument and to look, see if we either can dismantle that argument or look at it anew or somehow have another running jump at Pipes' argument. And for that reason, property interests me. Which is not to say you're not right, it's to talk about the genesis of my interest in this topic. Number two, my intent also was, I suppose if one were to speak of it in formalist terms, a kind of замедление. My attempt not to speed us along to a model that we understand all too quickly from a Western point of view, such as mafia. It doesn't therefore mean the mafia model is not correct. It's just that when one speaks to a Anglo audience, I think it's, I want it to make it not so easy for them to assume, therefore, they can put all the chess pieces on the board in their own way and play the game without me. And therefore, I want to make it difficult for them by trying to look at it at a slightly different angle than the one that they're familiar with. Third of all, there's a lot of very interesting work that's recently been done. First of all, there's Yanni's work in property. Second of all, there is this Katya Pravilova at Yale University Press who has a new book out on empire that talks about public good, common property. There is work by Marina Winkler, or Winkler, I think, I don't know if she's a German or not. She comes from Stanford, does interesting work. Dmitry Timofeyev and so forth, who are also grappling with, and there's a guy at Smithsonian as well, who's newly working with property issues. So it isn't so much a question of what is right or wrong. It's a question of a kind of not intellectual tusovka, because I don't know these people. I don't know them personally, and I'm just becoming acquainted with their work. But I'm particularly interested in property as location, because it is the most difficult to dissolve into the bath of neoliberalism and come out with nothing, coming out with just a wire transfer of funds, you know. If you have a grand, old, heavy building that occupies downtown and you want to turn it into a wire transfer, it's a very, for me at least, conceptually, it's a very complicated task. And that explains not how one of us is right and one is wrong, but rather the genesis of my interest. And I'll say finally that where cinema, for example, is evident, and you mentioned, you know, these historic sites, sacred sites, and so forth, is what's happening in Crimea now with cinema, where they have now launched a new festival, new film festival of patriotic and nationalist films, and giving out very large prizes, and inviting Western scholars to go to Crimea to attend this, all expenses paid, and to live in a nice hotel. You know, you can see it has the a Soviet smell to it in certain ways, but it's clearly making of culture something that is very different from how we understand, how I and my colleagues understand culture to be. I'll put it that way. Elliot.
So I was wondering, this was a fantastic talk, by the way.
Thank you.
I was wondering if you would see any value in a connection between everything you've been talking about today and smaller examples of a kind of government assault on materiality, like the destruction of the imported cheese and so on and so forth, that has been referred to in terms of potlatch. It's interesting that one of the things that seemed to characterize the first round of Putin's reign was this really something that seems to me unusual for Russian culture, this sort of broad-based comfort with material objects and possessions and obtaining and collecting them and having them. And now we have the expropriation of property, but we also have the sense that even the very consumer things that made life perhaps different are themselves subject to the power of the state as something that's being exerted just to show, in part to show the state's power.
Yeah. There has never been a time when it hasn't been a dark time. I've been going to that, to Russia for almost a half century now, since I was a teenager, in my middle teenage years. And there's never been a time when it hasn't been a dark time. But what's painful about this particular time and the cheese drama is, I understand the critics of Masha Gessen, I understand that. I understand both sides of the argument. But it seems to me what is very small-minded in all of that discussion is that the very things that are sources of comfort, the material things that are sources of comfort and sustenance and getting by and living one's life, are the things that have become punitively associated with let's take it away from them and let's shame them for wanting it in the first place. It's a tag team, you know, back and forth over these 50 years of who is more materialistic, the United States citizens, I won't say the Americans, but let's say the United States citizens or the Russians. And it's a ridiculous argument, but it seems to me odd that particularly at the time when the material goods are being taken from the stores, and we've all seen the YouTube clips of, you know, them raiding the stores and taking the foreign foods out, that as that is being scraped from the grocery stores, at the same time there's this other scraping that goes on of the excavator, that clearing the site for the next reception hall, at which there will be, probably, very good cheese imported from Belarus, yeah. Yeah. Listen.
Thank you, Nancy, for a really magisterial talk and, a kind of a synthesis of the material and the cultural that we really long for in our field. My question, maybe it's a small request for, for a specification of the relationship between state organized property seizure and cultural representation of the same. And you suggested at some point early in the talk that that the kind of intensification of representations that we see in contemporary cinema is a reflection of an actual economic process, but I was wondering whether you could make that relationship, maybe slightly more chronologically specific. You know, you suggested how, you know, in the 90s it was really often the private sector that was mm-hmm. doing that privatization. You know, and I have really little idea when the, you know, if you have a sense of the chronology of the volume of state appropriation through time and how culture reflects it, whether it's a direct relationship. And because it occurs to me that cinema itself, you know, as you suggested at the beginning with the outer film studio, cinema itself has been appropriated mm-hmm. and statified through various ways. So maybe cinema is not the best medium to reflect on that material process. Maybe it is other media that are less dependent on state resources.
So your comment has two parts. Number one, historicization, and the other, the appropriateness mm-hmm. of cinema.
Yes, and if you permit me, mm-hmm. you know, it's also a very small mm-hmm. comment, you know, which people have heard me say, but, you know, there is a sense in which I've got to repeat it. You know, even though you qualified very much your reflection on the polls, suggesting a very cohesive Russian culture and a cohesive set of attitudes towards the state. I have to say that those polls not only reflect those realities, but also produce them, and produce essentially the realities needed by the people conducting the polls, you know, whether it is a Levada Center which is actually invested in maintaining a minority culture of liberals and intellectuals, you know, that is surrounded and overwhelmed by this, by the 80 or however many percent of, mm-hmm. you know, Putin barbarians, Putin lovers and illiberals. So, yes, just, maybe to express my own unhappiness with such polls.
Mm-hmm. So, briefly, I'll try to keep it to a sentence or two per issue. Historicization, cinema, and the polls. I'll start with the polls. I don't want to be right. I don't like what the polls are saying, and I don't trust the polls. But I also am very uncomfortable with how quickly we change the subject to the unreliability of the polls, that we can't, what would it be like to imagine an increasingly cohesive? I mean, we see it in the United States as well with Trump, you know. What if we are seeing an increasingly cohesive nationhood forming under our very eyes, and that we need to disavow it, and so we need to change the subject? I'm in no point positioned to talk about the adequacy of the Russian polls, but I would love to be present at a conversation in which it's not simply deflected about the polls are unreliable, a fact with which I would agree. It's a minor point, but as for cinema, there's actually, I'll try to keep this very brief. There's very interesting stuff going on in, relatively speaking, independent cinema. I think one can still speak of independent cinema. Sigarev, for example, does very interesting work. His Strana Oz, Land of Oz, that just came out, is a very interesting film, and his previous works are very interesting. Mizgirev is a very interesting character. There is, of course, in certain ways, the kind of neoliberal extravaganza in cinema, Fede Bondarchuk's and so forth, who does very good films in certain ways, but in other ways, this increasing tendency to make films about Soviet icebreakers, about Soviet astronauts, about Soviet athletes, the courting of Western athletes to come to Russia and even to be offered citizenship, strikes me as the nurturing of a certain kind of archaic masculinity that has an attendant politics to it that is very much part and parcel of our time today, both in our country and over there. So I'll say that. There's a, there, quite apart from that wing of cinema that does the space trip and the lyrical and so forth, there's some very interesting stuff. Leviathan didn't come out of nowhere, in other words, and there are a number of very talented directors. As for historicization, I have this weird sensation that I'm seeing things in real time and making sense of them about 6 months after real time. So it's almost like bad drugs, you know. But I would characterize the historical period, for me at least, as the second Putin presidency. The second Putin presidency is the time when things begin to take more discernible shape, in part because it's a, it has been a stabler time up until now.
Thought-provoking talk. I just have a quick question. You mentioned Perry Anderson's article in Critical Inquiry, which I'm not familiar with. I'm familiar with the recent article that he wrote in the New Left Review called Unfittable Russia.
That's the one. Yeah.
Right.
He and draws on other people's work for his notion of concessionary capitalism, but nevertheless, it's an interesting argument.
Right. And if I remember correctly, the argument. Its claim is somewhat more maybe optimistic in the sense that it thinks of the tendencies currently in Russia of, on the one hand, this kind of globalized liberalism, neoliberalism, and on the other hand, state control as in some sense contradictory and potentially productive of crisis, ultimately productive of crisis, which is a familiar, of course, argument. Who knows, you know, he also cites at the end an authority who predicted the crisis 10 years ago that predicted the crisis that never happened. But I wonder if what your attitude is to that claim within that article and whether or not we can also think of cohesiveness in this connection as conjuncturally produced. In other words, we can over-narrate cohesiveness. Right. And this is a somewhat separate argument from Rosen's, right? It may be there, but it can just as easily sort of vanish or be produced.
Absolutely.
And vanished. And there's no reason to think of increasingly cohesive,
right?
But potentially cohesive for now.
Yeah. As for optimism, maybe this is like the black lung disease of miners. But I have tremendous difficulty being optimistic as I look ahead at Russia. And I don't know whose interests would be served by a crisis. In other words, it's classic that neoliberalism creates crises or manipulates crises to produce certain kinds of opportunities to step in and to resolve those crises to its own advantage. I understand that argument that David Harvey and others have produced. And I understand the for argument of Argentina and so forth. I get that. What I found uncomfortable about Perry Anderson's argument was the notion that crisis would be a good thing that it would bring to a head. I think that nothing is a good thing. You know, nothing is a good thing. And it's a fascinating topic, but I am sure glad that I'm not living in the midst of it because the people that themselves are in this particular environment, stability didn't serve them well, crisis didn't serve them well, and it's hard to know when, you know, your neighbor or the person on the bus says, you know, essentially what should Russia do for itself. I think there's going to be more of the same. It's simply going to be more of the same. And in that respect, I think to bring optimism to bear on the situation is to be delusional. And I don't think crisis will help either. So that's a cheery a cheery attitude. I, you know, I'm not a policy person. I just see a great deal more, another decade of this same jockeying for position with the intellectuals having absolutely no traction whatsoever. You know, you'd think they would get traction with Leviathan in the cultural sphere, but, you know, it just, even the parodies of Leviathan were devastating.
When you're speaking so hopelessly, I thought you were talking about us, not them. But the traction of the intellectuals and whatnot. If you don't mind, I'll pose you a question as well. First of all, when it comes to the polls, they're very well done. You know, the Levada Institute does wonderful polls. And they're very trustworthy in terms of the technique. But it's always the question of what questions they ask and what questions they don't ask, right?
Yeah.
So if you were to research, for example, you know, the Soviet Union collapsed and private property was brought into being in 1991, right? It hasn't been that long. It'd be fair to ask the population, what do you think of private property, right? Are you strongly in favor, strongly opposed? They don't ask, right? Mm-hmm. Or the other one, which is, what do you think of income inequality? They don't ask.
Yeah.
They will ask, what do you think, you know, do you think entrepreneurs should keep the fruits of their hard labor? Well, yeah, I guess, you know, so, you know, that, you know what I'm talking about? Is that kind of thing. So, you know, imagine that Fox News was making the poll, right? It's a poll, right? But it's, anyway, that's the polls part. But the part that I really liked about your talk is that, you know, I understood that this was not a talk about film, right? Film was the occasion to talk about many things.
Yes.
Right? When it comes to this question of property, first of all, just as a footnote, Anne O'Donnell is here, who's our new colleague in history, who's writing a whole dissertation on the early origins of value, among other things, property in the Soviet Union, and the great confusion that surrounded this whole problem of property. Mm-hmm. You'll have, I'm sure, many occasions to chat. So pipes, right? Mm-hmm. So pipes is pipes, right?
You know,
he's very good at what he does, right? And he puts forward the proposition, which he takes on faith, that there's only one kind of property that's worth thinking about, and that's private property, mm-hmm. as it emerges in England in the 17th century, in the midst of the English Civil War, which then becomes the universal model, right? Mm-hmm. Well, that's pipes, you know, that's fine, right? And so we more or less know what to do with that. Well, that was England in the 17th century, and you know, it may or may not be universalized, and even when it's universalized, it doesn't mean the same thing when it moves, right? Mm-hmm. It never even meant that in England. But there's more, which is that there's this long tradition of Russian argument about where any property comes from, which reminds us that anywhere you go globally, property is always a function of the state, right? Mm-hmm. It's no matter what kind of property you're talking about. There's a particular argument that took place in Russia in the late empire, which is then revived more recently, which goes like this. They say, well, you claim that you have private property. Now, so you're disrupting this whole binary of state and private property, mm-hmm. right, which I very much appreciate. Mm-hmm. And one could go even more, and it's almost epistemological. You claim that you have private property. Show me. Right? So well, here it is. Well, now you've just made it public, so it's no longer private mm-hmm. by showing it to me. Do you want me to protect it? Yes. Well, register it. Right. Mm-hmm. Put it in state books. Mm-hmm. I'll pass laws to protect it, but it only exists because it's no longer private, you see. Mm-hmm. So if you want private property, you better be careful because it's always conditional because they could change these laws, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. There's something very similar happening in Russia today, I find. It could happen elsewhere in smaller areas, which is that sure, you know, conditionally you can take this studio, you can take the Ergia, the archive in St. Petersburg, which was about to be taken over by a combination casino brothel, right? Mm-hmm. Which made its
always
way
useful.
Oh, yeah, oh, necessary. The basement was actually taken over by casino brothel. Mm-hmm. And then the state stepped in and said, well, it will no longer be an archive. It's going to be Putin's St. Petersburg residence. Mm-hmm. It's an Angliska Nabirizhna, which is it's a very nice building, right? It's the old Senate House. And the but what they were saying was that, you know, everything is conditional, right? So the casino is out, right? These things are out. So, you know, wherever you go, you know, we might say here the property, private property is defined as such because it exists outside of the state and it's its antipode. Mm-hmm. But the Russians are always reminding that no, even private property is necessarily a relation to the state. Mm-hmm. Right?
Mm-hmm. And concessionary.
Yeah, anywhere and always, mm-hmm. right.
Yeah, absolutely. And what I would love to see, again, of the great article, unwritten articles that I'm not competent to write but would be stand in line a long time to have the privilege of reading would be one that looked at early concessionary practices of Catherine II and the ways in which the concessionary practices that she put into place and have endured since that time and the way in which that model has been seen as a local set of opportunities distinct from the West. Again, it's for people like you or Pravilova or Winkler to look at. But for us that work in other cultural fields, we would welcome that kind of research.
I guess I'll just ask my question after all. This was fascinating, thank you. And speaking of Pravilova and her work, one of the points that she makes is that the issue of private property, the many various types of property that are at work in any society, Russia or otherwise. So mm-hmm. private property is one variant, mm-hmm. but of course public property
yes.
is another, and it's public property where there are particular weaknesses in the imperial model. And I'm curious how you would place public property in the landscape you're describing, particularly perhaps vis-a-vis a word that came up a lot, this notion of homeland.
Mm-hmm.
Is it the state solely that would defend a concept of the public?
Mm-hmm.
It's absent today, but mm-hmm. how in the landscape you're describing does that absence express itself?
I'm very suspicious of that concept of public property or common goods in Russia, in part because if we look simply at its provenance, if we take as a given, for example, the idea that the concept of private property is a kind of ontological, kind of classical liberal concept, and it also is closely linked to the sense of the sovereign self. Common property or public property, absent a robust civil society, doesn't make sense to me. I can't make any sense, conceptual sense of it. In other words, I understand that civil society one can take as a Western construction, right? And is tightly linked with all notions of property, both private property and common property or public property. But if you've got no civil society as we think of civil society in the West, then it seems to me that what you have left that you might easily call, if you wish, public property is indistinguishable from state property. That there, I don't find it compelling that there's a distinction. It seems to me a merely rhetorical distinction. I know that there's a distinction in the West, a functional one. No, I know we're not arguing. I'm trying to imagine what it would be like to have a public property without something resembling Western civil society, which I am not lauding at the moment. It's not that I think civil society is a wonderful thing, we should have it, you know, right? That's not my argument. But rather, as a giraffe or a leopard or a whatever in that zoo, if it's not here, how do things hold together? And I can't conceptualize public property without robust civil society as it's conceived of in the West.
So I wonder how do you conceptualize the sort of seizure mentality, the seizure apparatus that's going on right now with the kind of the arguments that are being made now about the primacy of state, the state property and state seizing property and being able to take property with the kind of robber barons argument,
mm-hmm.
right, that was prevalent a bit in the early 90s, that if you have individuals who are seizing, who are getting the assets, eventually it's going to be in the interest of those individuals to have robust property rights.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not, I mean, there is in today's sort of, whatever, if you want to call the historical era of this, of Putin too, right, it's not, it is obviously there's a primacy of the state, there's a primacy of the state in being the ultimate arbiter and making these, as Yanni's talking about, these property decisions and who gets the property and what happens to this building and which ways it goes. But ultimately, there are also, going back to the very first question, there are individuals who are becoming tremendously enriched by this process.
Mm-hmm.
And these individuals have long-term interests. Now, one can make the argument that it's in the interest of other actors to keep people who have become enriched on their toes and
mm-hmm.
realizing that that's not permanent. But on the other hand, there are these sort of long-term processes by which if you're Putin and you ever plan to step down from the presidency, you want to have some security over the property that you've accumulated in this point in time. And there are other people like that as well.
Mm-hmm.
So is there an internal dynamic, or is this sort of something distinctly different about the dynamic here, that this is a perpetual state-run seizure of property that goes to individuals who are associated with the state in a particular way? Or is this just a longer process than what we thought it might have been in the early 1990s, where the arguments were made that you want to get property in individual hands, so you create stakeholders for providing robust property rights?
I'll say two things. One of the arguments that is currently in play that I find very interesting, it's not my idea, so I won't pass it off as if it were my own, is this notion that I think Sakwa talks about it, but also Easter and a number of other scholars, about Russian wealth being different from, let's say, the robber barons of our culture, in the sense that they're a state creation. Clearly, there are exceptions to that, but they were allowed to make money because they were allowed to make money, and that money can be taken from them, as we've seen in the case of Khodorkovsky and others. They can be squashed if it's necessary to squash them, so that even what they have, namely a pact with the state where you can keep your millions and I expect fealty from you, I expect loyalty from you, that they can lose that very wealth, and which is precisely why the governing boards need to be populated by those people that, whether they have their wealth or not, they are loyal to the state, so that any organization can be emptied out or any property can be seized, and things can change at a great accelerated rate, precisely because they don't own their own wealth to begin with. Now, I think that Easter overstates his case. He talks as if none of the rich people in Russia own their are products of their own wealth, but they were put into an environment in which they were permitted to enrich themselves, but that they can be de-enriched at the drop of a hat. I think it's an overstatement, but I think it's a very, what is interesting to me about it is it puts its finger on the difference between our robber barons and those robber barons, number one. Number two, there's also an interesting moment that seems to me is coming to fruition, and that is when the oligarch's children, who are now, you know, in their 20s and 30s, coming into their own with the expectation that they will continue to run the companies, to have the billions, to travel abroad, to have the jets, to own the palaces, and so forth. Is that something, if we're talking about concessionary capitalism, is that something that is in the interests of Putin's inner circle? Does he, in fact, want that wealth to be dropped down a generation, or does he need to renew his circle to put new people in it? And I think that that's an implicit struggle that's going on today. If we look at, I don't have the specific names in front of me now, but one of the things that I was looking at about 4 or 5 days ago is, who are the sons and daughters of the oligarchs, where are they placed, and how are they spending their money? And whether that would constitute a kind of congenital wealth that would be able to tell its story as kind of real wealth or authentic wealth or born wealth, trust fund people, rather than people that voted the right way at the right time with Putin and therefore were rewarded in a concessionary fashion by Putin. I don't have an answer to that, but I think that's the tension that you see at the present moment with those people that are, you know, in their 30s, let's say, who are the sons and daughters of the oligarchs.
Just a quick note. One way to formulate it also is to look at, you know, if you make a lot of money here in civil society, you can buy a politician, right? And you can buy a government. You can run for office. I mean, I think there should be no doubt by now that our government is money oriented. It depends on having money, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas in Russia, if you enter government, that's how you get your money. You see. So mm-hmm. It's Putin II in particular. You know, because Putin I was about, you know, still part of Yeltsin's era. Mm-hmm. You leave the government and take wealth with you.
Yes.
And it's private. Mm-hmm. That era is over, and so what you do now is you enter government, and that's how you access wealth. So it reestablishes an old relationship where you politics comes first and wealth second. Right?
Yes.
And mm-hmm. Whereas here, of course, it's wealth first and politics.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah. Yeah, and of course that's a tremendous oversimplification, but as a heuristic, it's an interesting, it's a way of identifying a breakpoint between mm-hmm. the two.
If there are no more questions, we should thank our speaker
thank
for,
you very
again,
much for having
complicating
me.
Things in useful ways.
Yeah, thank you.